Hello everyone, I'm really excited today because we have with us a very special guest. We're going to be talking strategy. Everybody wants great strategy for the business and everybody wants to grow their business. So who better to talk about strategy than Ian Heller, Chief Strategy Officer and co-founder of Distribution Strategy Group. Ian, thank you so much for joining. And it's an honor and pleasure to have you join DCKAP's Driven by DCKAP podcast.
Well, thank you for including me, Karthik. I'm really excited to be here.
Thank you, Ian. Ian, I just want to get started with the basics. Let's say I'm going to college doing my bachelor's in strategy 101. What is strategy? How do you define strategy and why is strategy important?
Yeah, well, strategy is a long-term plan to differentiate your firm from everybody else. I think it was Peter Drucker who said the purpose of strategy is to avoid competition. You know, so that means differentiation, right? You do something better and different than what other people do. And so a strategy is a long-term plan to accomplish that, but it comes to life when you figure out, okay, what are my core competencies going to be? How am I going to be, you know, what industry am I in? What core competencies am I going to develop? And then what are the programs I will develop within those core competencies, right? So those are the growth initiatives, the differentiation initiatives, which may be anywhere from, you know, developing software to special distribution. It might be service capabilities. It might be product lines that others don't carry. It might be level of service. Customer experience is often, you know, a real differentiator for distributors. And then it's all the supporting things you have to do to make that happen. And so that is, what's the financial plan? What are the financial goals? What's the budget that we're going to spend to make these things come true? How are we going to test them? You know, if you ever read Innovator's Dilemma, he talks about how you can't really test programs in an operating environment. If you really have to create a separate environment, because if you try to test new initiatives with the people who run the regular P&L, they tend to view them as distractions and they snuff them out. So you have to test some things in a in more of a lab environment. And then what's the HR plan? What's the talent plan to get things in place? So I think it's a combination of answering your core competency. Strategy is answering your core competency questions. It's putting together a long-term differentiation plan. It's creating the initiatives that result in that differentiation and then figuring out how you support them with money and people.
I can relate to what you said because this is a mistake we have done in the past. Let's say you run an experiment and you got to do it in parallel or have another team do it, because if it gets involved in your P&L, then the experiment gets affected, but also the P&L gets affected because the focus is not there. You know? So I could really relate to that. It's really great. And you talked about Peter Drucker, and what about his famous quote, "Culture eats strategy for breakfast"? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of truth to that, but I think you can overdo that. And here's what I mean. For a while, there was a meme going around LinkedIn, and it said something like, you know, Blockbuster wasn't killed by Netflix, it was killed by late fees. And taxis weren't killed by rude behavior, or they weren't killed by Uber, they were killed by rude behavior, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And it was the most nonsensical post, because Blockbuster was not going to survive renting media to anybody, no matter what they did, no matter what their policies were. That became technologically outmoded. Uber is just a better solution for short distance transportation than taxis are. So yeah, I mean, culture can eat strategy for breakfast, but culture can get destroyed by technology innovations too. I mean, Kodak may have had a phenomenal culture and the entire city of Rochester, New York was employed, built, you know, making film in these gigantic factories. And they had Kodak softball teams and healthcare providers and daycare. I mean, those people couldn't look at those millions of square feet of plants making film and ever imagine it going away. But the world's finest culture wasn't going to protect Kodak from digital photography, right? So I think, yeah, culture can eat strategy for breakfast, but innovation can eat culture if you fall behind.
No, certainly. And you've got to keep reinventing yourself, and also don't do the same good thing for too long, even if you are very good at it. Yeah, totally makes sense. And even the culture needs to keep evolving. You know, just can be stagnant. Can totally relate to that. Everybody wants to be strategic. And how do you know that the strategy you deploy is working? Sometimes it takes time to see the light. How do you deal with that?
Yeah, well, there's no guarantee, right? I mean, you have to test some things. You know, I think if you are in a company that is willing to invest in innovation, then they know there are going to be some failures along the way, right? No guarantees. I think, again, if you get the experiment out of the operating P&L and you get it into a more of a laboratory environment and let it run parallel to the business for a while, and you don't measure it strictly on the financials it produces on its own, but more on sort of a pro forma. It's like, well, yeah, this experiment's not profitable, but you know, that's because we're not over our fixed costs. And if we scaled it up, we would be, you know. So I think it takes some iterations of analysis to figure out if an innovation is going to be successful. But ultimately, you have to have some measurements around these things, and you can't give tests forever to run, but it's easy to be impatient and not give them enough time to at least see if it's going to work. Also have to have the right people working on it, you know, but I think set realistic objectives. They can be challenging, but realistic, and then evaluate along the way and realize that almost no new idea is perfect the way it's born. And you're probably going to have to adapt it to the real world in order to make it work in the long run.
I think this is some great execution advice. Whatever experiment you run, keep it outside of your operating P&L, and the people matter. So why do companies come to you, Ian? Why do companies come to your company, and what are the typical problems they come for, and how do you help them?
So, I mean, if you think about what we do, most of it is we provide thought leadership and analytics. So the thought leadership takes the form of webinars and discussion panels between technology leaders or between distribution executives. We did an event in the fall called Applied AI for Distributors. We're doing another one in June. And we'll have, you know, 300 thought leaders from across distribution and from technology companies who will be discussing how do you apply artificial intelligence to a distribution company. So, and then we have three analytics products. One sort of helps you understand your end market demand. One measures customer net promoter score, and one measures employee engagement, right? So these are, everything we do is sort of designed to help executives run better companies and get better outcomes by providing the best expertise we possibly can. We do a little bit of consulting. We used to be a consulting company. Now it's a relatively small part of our revenue, and it tends to be around strategic planning or marketing planning. So we do some keynote speeches and some custom engagements. But anyway, that's the short answer to what we do for a living.
Awesome. And you talked about artificial intelligence or AI, and it's actually an overused term in today's market. They always keep talking about AI. Can you share a couple of use cases where AI has been effectively used and deployed by distributors and how it's changing the course of their business?
Yeah. So I think, you know, a couple of good examples are around recommender engines, right? So if you're trying to figure out what to buy online, or if you're placing an online order and you get recommended something that's very useful to you, or if you're on a phone call with a customer service rep and they recommend something that you may have forgotten that's related to what you need, I think that's a useful case. I'm seeing AI used in working capital application or management, particularly inventory. You know, I remember years ago when I was at Grainger, we used to have a saying that there are two kinds of inventory forecasts, wrong ones and lucky ones. And, you know, I think what we've learned since then is that applying AI in the right way to inventory can make you luckier in your inventory forecast.
So essentially, a recommendation engine and inventory forecast in terms of forecasting the inventory.
But there's a lot more. I mean, I've seen AI applied to AR. So it helps you understand where you need to make a phone call to someone who owes you money versus where you can just send emails. I've seen it in delivery routing, right, where you figure out the most efficient delivery route for your trucks, which is an unbelievably complex problem, by the way, that seems easy. You see it in warehouses. They've got security systems that will tell you whether or not a driver on a forklift is wearing a seatbelt the way that they're supposed to. It detects fraud. There are drones that fly around and count inventory in certain situations that are all AI enabled. I actually just published a column, which I argue that AI has more potential in distribution than in retail. And the reason is that distribution is a lot harder and a lot more complex than retail. And until now, there haven't been technology solutions available for some of the harder problems that distributors face. And AI is actually providing those solutions. So I think it's a, you know, from demand generation to financial settlement to collecting rebates from your suppliers, there are AI applications across the range.
So this is very interesting. And yeah, it can definitely be applied in delivery and a lot of other use cases you talked about. Do you see distributors actively using this in their business, or how much adoption, how much AI adoption are you seeing?
Very little so far, but it's growing. What I'm seeing is distributors under pressure to apply AI. So they're getting questions from their boards of directors or their, you know, PE owners or the public markets if they're a big public company asking, hey, what are you doing with AI? I mean, people don't even really know what they're asking in many cases. They don't, you know, they don't really know the difference between advanced technology and AI, even though they are different. But they know, wow, I've got my money in this company and they should be using AI to get some kind of an advantage. And I keep reading about it and seeing it on 60 Minutes. So that's really where the pressure is coming from, right? Plus, you know, the executives themselves read about AI and feel like there's something they can do with it. But I think, you know, the actual implementation is really primarily coming from vendors they already have who are putting AI into their existing products, or, you know, smaller technology companies that are catching the attention of distributors and getting implemented in certain cases. So I think it's coming, but there's a long, long way to go.
Yeah. Can you talk about an example where you applied strategy to a distributor and it really worked and it changed the course of their business?
Yeah. So I was thinking about this because you had suggested this question in advance. And I think, you know, I've done a lot of strategies for a lot of distributors, and I don't really want to take credit for somebody else's work, because it's one thing to put together the plan. It's another to execute it, right? But, you know, when I was, for example, when I was at White Cap Construction Supply, you know, when I got there, we were $857 million. When I left, we were, I don't know, $2.5 billion or something. And that was in 7 years, right? So there were a lot of people that drove that growth. I mean, sales reps, regional vice presidents, district sales managers, branch managers. So I just had a small part to play. But the part that I did play was rapidly expanding the customer base by being paranoid, if you will, obsessed with customer acquisition, retention, and wallet share growth of existing customers, which is something that they had never looked at before, right? When I went there, the customer count was declining year over year and had been for 5 years. And this was in 2010, I guess. And so by putting those metrics in place and aggressively marketing to new customers, and we did it in a number of ways through a number of channels, what I call the golden rule of marketing is the more frequently distributor marketing, the more frequently you put relevant offers in front of targeted customers, the more frequently they'll buy from you. So if I put something interesting in front of a customer on a regular basis, they'll buy from me more frequently than if I don't do that. And that works to acquire new customers. It keeps customers from leaving you, and it gets your existing customers to buy more often. And we saw this enormous turnaround in number of customers and purchase frequency and improvements in retention. And that's an area where marketing helped the salespeople and the other individuals in the company grow the business.
Totally. And strategy is teamwork. And yeah, it makes a lot of sense. You know, even for us as a company, which is relating to what you said, for us to just focus on the distribution market was a strategy by itself.
Yeah.
And it's paying rich dividends. And we came to that working just by teamwork, right? So we keep discussing and people get together and then you execute, you win on some, you lose on some, and then it works. And if it doesn't work, you just pull back. Yeah.
But so, I have a question for you, Karthik, if I may. You work across the enterprise for distributors, right? From ERP to e-commerce to CRM to analytics. I mean, you see where you're working with distributors on technology implementations and selections much more than I am. Where do you see them applying AI?
Where do I see AI being applied?
Yeah. And where's the potential? Where do you think?
Yeah, totally. I think the big potential is making systems talk to each other and using AI for that. Yeah, the biggest problem distributors have today is the systems don't talk to each other. And when the data is not moved from one system to another, then it is a challenge and you're not able to provide that great experience for your customers. You talked about product recommendations, or you talked about AI being applied in delivery. For all this to work, for AI to work, the systems need to talk to each other. And once the system talks to each other, once the data is integrated, you have access to a lot of data. I mean, for AI to work, the primary thing, as you know, is data.
Yeah.
And the data is right now in different systems. And the distributors where the systems talk to each other, they're able to apply AI really effectively. And that's what we are focusing on. Yeah.
Right. So with the systems, so you'll help advise them on which systems to choose, but then integrating that data and preparing it for the application of, I don't know, generative AI or more narrow AI solutions, that's part of what you do.
Correct. Yeah. We have an integration. We offer an integration platform for distributor called the DCKAP integrator. Yeah.
Right. Got it. Interesting.
So Ian, we talked about a strategy that worked and you talked about strategy being teamwork and makes a lot of sense. Tell us something where a strategy you deployed and it failed miserably. What did you learn from it?
Yeah. I don't think we have enough time to go through all those.
Just tell me one.
So I was thinking about this too. I mean, I think, you know, I don't know that I've done one that's like outright failed. I've recommended things that didn't work or I've missed things that, you know, I mean, I like to think of myself as a strategist and kind of a futurist and I see what's coming. But I'll tell you, when I was at Grainger, you know, I think I left Grainger in 1998. And somewhere around then, I worked for this guy named Don Belinsky, who was a senior VP. And I also worked for Wes Clark. I had this dual reporting to these presidents, group presidents that had totally different responsibilities. And Wes ran the whole branch network, which is, and I had, you know, started as a truck unloader and was a branch manager. And so, you know, that was my background. And Don had this crazy idea where he'd get these third-party sellers to sell on Grainger.com. And basically what he dreamed up was Amazon Business 20 years before Amazon Business. And I thought he was nuts. I thought there's no way anyone's ever going to do that. Now, that initiative didn't work, but it was an execution failure related to the technology not being ready. Okay, you couldn't move product data around and it wasn't standardized. And, you know, there weren't fast enough connections to do efficient shopping with that many SKUs. But it was a brilliant idea, and Don was way ahead of the curve, and I missed it completely. I didn't understand it. And so my perspective is, you know, you can't have too many of those misses if you want to consider yourself a strategist in your career. And, you know, I guess I was right from the standpoint that the world wasn't ready for it, but I thought the idea was bad. I didn't think it would fail on execution. I thought it was a bad idea. Turns out it was a brilliant idea that the world wasn't ready for yet. And so I got to tell you, whenever I start feeling a little bit too smart about my successes, I think about that and realize, oh my gosh, that was one of the biggest trends in the history of e-commerce. And I thought it was a dumb idea when I heard about it. And, you know, hopefully I'm smarter than I was back then. But, you know, Don Belinsky, you know, he's never going to go in any books as a leading thinker about online commerce. But the reality is he had these ideas long before anybody else did, at least that I know of. And I'm sure there were others at Grainger, but that's the one where it's like, oh my gosh, I just didn't see it. And, you know, that really humbles me because it was such a big idea and I missed it entirely. So that's a different answer than the question you asked for, but that's the one that really jumps out in my history.
Oh, that's a great answer. And it's a humbling experience. So thanks for sharing that, Ian. It means a lot. You touched upon e-commerce a little bit. And how do you recommend distributors measure the ROI, the return on investment of their e-commerce platforms beyond just shopping cart sales, taking into account the role of digital interaction in keeping and winning customers?
Yes, I think the worst thing that's happened to distributor e-commerce is these experts, so-called experts, coming in saying that you should build your B2B website like a B2C site and measure it the same way. That has been so destructive to investment in e-commerce capabilities for distributors because it's completely wrong, right? So distributors are doing what retailers do. Here's my ROI model. So I'm going to take my costs, which I know they're precise. I know how much I'm spending. I know what my payroll is, et cetera. They're pretty robust, pretty complete. And then I'm going to divide that into my shopping cart sales, which is the measliest, most ridiculous way to account for the value of your website, because in B2B is not B2C. Our customers have much more complex needs, right? So they might be on your website all the time getting valuable information about their historical purchases or getting training or doing all kinds of things that make them want to buy from you more often and make them addicted to your company and never buy online. Well, that doesn't mean your website's not adding value. It means you're not capturing that value. And the second thing is professional buyers don't for the most part, buy through a shopping cart. I mean, yeah, there are e-procurement platforms, and for small stuff, they do that. But you look at the average distributor, their customers are buying with POs that they're either calling in or they're emailing in, and they're leaving the shopping cart out of it entirely, even if the purchase was generated by the shopping, by the website. And so I think there are two things that distributors should do. So here's the quick answer, the short answer to your question after the long answer. Two things they should do. The first thing that distributors should do is they should look at the correlation between how much customers use the website and how much they buy overall. So we've run that on distributors before and found a 99% correlation. I mean, nothing's ever 99%, as you know, Karthik. We found a 99% correlation between how engaged customers are on your website and how much they buy overall. So if they're on your website all the time, they buy more, even if they're not buying through the website. That's one thing. The second thing is, I think distributors should call 50 customers a month who didn't buy on the web and say, hey, did you use our website in the course of placing that order? And whatever that percentage is, give the attribution to the website for those orders, extrapolate it across your firm. Now you've got a real number for your ROI model. You do those two measurements, and it's easy. Just call. And by the way, you don't call the customer and just tell them, hey, just ask them if they use the web. You say, hey, this is a customer service call. How was your experience with us? I'm not trying to sell you anything. I mean, how many of us would not be delighted to get a call like that from a supplier? And you engage them in a conversation, you know, and then you ask them along, as part of this customer service follow-up, did you use the website? And if they say yes, then do a little research. How'd you like it? What other websites do you buy from? What would you like to have on our website that we don't offer, right? So take those 50 calls or 100 or whatever and have an intern do them, or even better, have senior executives do them, since they probably don't get enough customer contact. Calculate your ROI that way, and then correlate engagement on your website to overall sales. And I think what distributors are going to find is that their websites are producing 6 to 8 times more revenue than they know. And it's going to fundamentally change the investment profile for them. They're going to spend a lot more on digital capabilities once they realize how important these capabilities really are to customers.
Oh, well said, Ian. So just don't measure the orders being placed, but measure the engagement and correlate that to the total orders customers place on different platforms. Yeah. And if they are not placing orders on the e-commerce website, call the customer and see how you can help them. Yeah, great advice. So you focus a lot on research and development, and you track what's happening in the industry. So what are the top three must-do action items every distributor should know?
Well, you know, I looked at that question. It's a little hard because there's, you know, there are many different types of distributors. You know, I think distributors need to stay up to speed on AI, and they have to know what it is and how they might apply it. They have to understand it. They need to build AI talent onto their teams. So I think, you know, not getting behind on AI is one. I think two, they really need to understand the role of digital in their environment, because they don't. You know, the conversation that we just had, many of them don't anyway. I think that's two. And then three is nail the basics. You still have to be a distributor. And I see a lot of distributors trying to not be distributors anymore. And what I mean by that is, I don't want to carry inventory. I want to do these mini branches. You know why? Because I don't have to put inventory in them. Distributors carry inventory. They learn how to manage it well. They learn how to match the needs with their stocking decisions. They get all the supplier capabilities they can and put them in front of their customers. They employ great sales forces. They obsess about customer experience and service. There are no magic strategies that you can put in place as a distributor that relieves you of the responsibilities of doing those things well. And it's easy to take your eye off the ball and not focus on the basics because you're distracted by something else like AI. It's a do the basics and do this other stuff, not do the basics or this other stuff.
Yeah, top three, Ian Heller, to-do things. Nail the basics, digital, and AI.
Yeah.
I like that, Ian.
Thanks.
So Ian, switching back to strategy again, let's say I'm not a distributor, and how do one apply strategy to their career? How can someone apply strategy to their careers?
So like a personal career strategy, or how to become a strategist as part of your career?
No, how do you apply strategy, right? Not to become a strategist. Let's say, you know, I'm working at a distributor, or I'm doing some work. How can I be strategic so that I can advance my career?
Got it. Okay. So look, I think, you know, I started off as a truck unloader at a Granger branch, right? And left there as the VP of marketing. And I've done that job at three other big publicly held distributors. And what I've seen is that the people who get promoted nail their jobs. So they're really, really good. I mean, if you're the in charge of inventory management, you do a really good job with inventory management. But the second thing you need to do is you need to get involved in strategic initiatives, right? Now, almost always distributors, you know, if they're going to, hey, we're thinking about expanding into telesales, or we're thinking about doing, you know, job site branches, or we're thinking about doing a vending machine and bin replenishment program, whatever those strategic initiatives are, you need to get involved in them. And don't be too skeptical up front, because the world is changing. Those Kodak plants really did get shuttered. They closed down, right? The world is changing. And so you need to help your company explore things for the future. And that means, in addition to doing your regular job, when new ideas come along, you are an excited and fully engaged participant, and you help them figure out how to make them work, right? So it may be something like, hey, there's a new ERP coming. Well, don't be the cynic who's criticizing it and talking about how, oh, old ERP was better than a new one, right? I mean, you need to be the one who's embracing and making change happen, not be the, you know, the skeptic behind the scenes. It's really easy to be cynical. And I hate cynicism. I think it's poison in an environment, and eventually to be poison for your career. I think, you know, look, you don't need to be naive to be optimistic, but I think, you know, to be excited to engage in new ideas, be known as a person who helps them succeed, that doesn't mean you're not candid with management. I mean, if the new IP is not working, then you're there saying, here's what's not working, but you're there also to help them find solutions, not just pointing fingers. And I use ERPs because it's such a controversial implementation, but it applies to everything. And I think, you know, the spirit of the will to win, the optimism, the enthusiasm, the excitement, that's hard. Being a cynic who knows better than everybody else, it is the Monday morning quarterback who says, well, I would have done it differently. That's cheap and easy, and it doesn't help anybody.
Yeah, get out of your comfort zone, try new things, experiment, and be a part of the strategic initiatives in the company. So Ian, I'm just curious to know, how were you as a kid or your early days growing up? And how do you think your past contributes to where you are today?
Yeah, so I moved a lot. So I was born in Canada. My parents are from Germany and England, and we moved every few years. My dad was a minister most of my life, but my last name begins with the word hell, and I was usually the newest kid in town in a small town. So, you know, I scrapped a lot, right? So I think, you know, I'm pretty outgoing. Some of that's related to the fact that I had to change friends every four years. I think it, you know, I'm very comfortable in new situations, and that probably is because I did it so much when I was growing up. I know things are going to change because I've seen them. I live with constant change, and maybe that's why I'm interested in new technologies. I worked a lot of blue collar jobs. I did a lot of construction and farming before I went to college. So I don't know. I think everyone's a product of their upbringing to a certain degree, and mine was interesting and diverse and had its own challenges like everybody else's did. But I think that openness to change and that expectation that things are going to change and willingness to lead it if I can, rather than get victimized by it, that probably comes from that lifestyle. I wish we'd had one home that I grew up in, and every summer we went to the same place on the lake in Wisconsin, you know, or whatever. I don't know. I mean, I think I'm not sure what to make of these things, Karthik, you know, so I have five siblings, or grew up with five siblings. And, you know, they're not like all of us are equally outgoing, right? I mean, some are shyer than others. So I don't know the degree to which this nature versus nurture, but it's not fun to move. I don't wish that on anybody, but most people do.
Yeah. But I also think some people like it. So for instance, yeah, I've chatted with people where they have moved from one place to another, and they look back at that time when they were growing up, it was hard. But then they look back at it, like you rightly said, hey, you know, it helps you be a lot more outgoing, and you're able to make friends easily, new schools.
I hear you. I mean, when my kids were in high school, I was working from home, and I turned down corporate job offers because I told my kids I wouldn't move till they got out of high school. And I don't regret that. I mean, I think that was better for them. And I think we adapt and we grow based on whatever challenges life throws at us, but I don't think you know, moving all the time is a particular advantage versus not.
Totally, yeah. So during your career, is there anything you would have done differently if you had a chance? Any notable failures you've learned from or important lessons learned?
Yeah, I think early in my career, I was pretty passionate about things I perceived to be wrong. And I didn't really distinguish between things that were wrong decisions because I disagreed versus things that were like morally wrong, right? So like I was at Grainger for a long, for 15 years, right? Grainger's a very, very ethical company, always has been. And I never saw a leader there that I can recall ever do anything that was unethical. But man, I challenged them all the time on their business decisions. And sometimes I was angry and outraged and you know, I was young and full of it. And I knew everything, right? Unlike now where I don't. And I think what I learned is that early on, you know, maybe don't, I wish I'd had so much hubris about what I knew and I just listened and learned more. And I think you have to distinguish between things that happen that you disagree with versus things that might happen that are wrong, that are unethical. And the first ones don't justify the same outrage as the second ones. I mean, you know, the executives at Grainger at the time were probably a lot better than I gave them credit for. And they were very ethical players. And just because I disagreed with them, I would be kind of outraged. And I think you need to reserve your outrage. I wish I'd been more mature, I guess. And that probably, I mean, I got promoted a lot, but it probably cost me a couple of promotions that I would have had if I had not been so certain of what I knew and maybe was more a lot more humble about it.
No, totally. You know, it's a fine balance. You take the good and ignore the bad and work on the good and make it better.
Yeah.
And Ian, what advice do you have for dealing with stress and building healthy habits?
Yeah, I'm not a very good person to look to for that. I mean, you know, my fitness goes like this over the years. I get really fit for a while, then I'm not fit. And so I would say the one constant in my life is I really like to ride motorcycles. I'm not a Harley rider, nothing against it. I don't like big, heavy motorcycles. I like light, nimble, fast, you know, more sport bikes. So for me, it's incredibly relaxing and rejuvenating for me to ride a fast motorcycle through a canyon. And I live in Colorado, so I get to do that much of the year. But I think, you know, whatever you got to get your head out of your business sometimes and focus on something else. And, you know, you should be getting your cardio in and working out and eating a healthy diet. And I know when I do that, I feel a lot better. And when I don't, I don't. But the motorcycle is the constant. No matter, you know, by the way, I don't recommend motorcycling. It's really dangerous. It's probably very foolish, but you know, find your thing that you really like to do and don't neglect it just because you're busy.
Great. So tell us something crazy you've done in your life.
Something crazy I've done in my life. Yeah, I've done a lot of crazy things, a lot of them on motorcycles. So I've taken some crazy chances. I started a company at 57. I mean, I'm 60 now. And we started this company at 57, which was, you know, I told my wife at the time, if this doesn't work out, I'm going to be a Walmart greeter in my twilight years. So that was dumb. I mean, it's working, but it was dumb at the time. What else? I have left some executive jobs because I just got bored and wanted to do something else. Some of those decisions probably weren't great, but I don't really regret them.
What's something that would surprise others to know about you?
That I just wrote a novel. And I'm trying to get it published. And it's really hard to get it published, but it's a fun sort of action adventure novel with a sci-fi twist. And actually, I have one of the world's largest agencies right now is reading the manuscript, which is kind of a big deal because it's hard to get the attention of an agent. And so I'm hoping to get published this year. That's the thing that people don't expect, I guess, is especially, you know, I started writing it right as I started this company. So, you know, I was working a lot of hours, but it was a labor of love and I'm really proud of it. I think it's a good book.
Good luck with that.
Thanks.
Are there any books you would recommend for distributors or anyone who wants to be good at strategy?
Yeah, I'd read Good to Great. I'd read Goodbye. What was the sequel? Good by Choice or something like that by Jim Collins. The two classics by Jim Collins. I would read The Innovator's Dilemma. I think that's an important book. And I think, you know, you start with those. There's a bunch of other good ones out there, like just about anything by Peter Drucker, I think is really interesting. But I'd probably start with those three.
And what book are you reading right now, Ian?
Right now, I am reading Ghost Fleet, which is a sort of a futuristic sci-fi novel. It's a bestseller from 2015. So it's a pretty fun book. So I'm trying to read books that are similar to mine so I can talk about them intelligently with agents. So yeah, that's, I just started that one last night. So what are you reading right now?
The Design of Everyday Things, Don Norman.
That's a lot weightier than what I'm reading. How do you like that?
No, it's pretty good. I mean, it talks about the basics. So now every time I go out somewhere, this is something Don recommends in his book. So let's say you go out somewhere and you see something. Let's say you even see a door. See how it's designed. Is it easy to push or is it pull? Let's say if you get stuck, right? You try to pull it, but it pushes. Or you try to push it and it pulls or something like that. Then sometimes, you know, oftentimes when we try on a new product and things do not work, we blame ourselves. But then it's not us, you know, it's the design. So, hey, this should have been designed better.
Yeah.
They did not do it correctly. So it's a great read. And, you know, I'm learning a lot about design reading that. So it's very interesting.
So you'd recommend it to others?
Absolutely. Yeah, I definitely recommend that to others. And yeah, especially people in tech or any business for that matter. You know, design is a part of our everyday life.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a great book. Yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting because you need design and engineering, right? Because the engineers tend to not be great at making things easily usable. They make them incredibly functional, but not easily usable. And you need both, right?
Absolutely. And it's a part of daily life. And next time you see something which you're not able to figure out, don't blame it on yourself. Blame it on the designer. Hey, this should be done better.
I'll remember that. Good.
Yeah. So Ian, thank you so much for joining. It's been great chatting with you on strategy and a lot of other things and best ways to execute. I really love this conversation. Thank you for joining the Driven by DCKAP podcast. It's an absolute pleasure and honor to have you join us.
It was my honor. I really appreciate it. I enjoyed the conversation and look forward to the next time we talk, Karthik. So thanks very much.
One more thing. If you have not subscribed to our podcast, please click subscribe button. Thank you.
Thanks for joining us on this episode of the Driven Podcast. Check out our other episodes for more and subscribe to be the first to access every new episode.